you.
Hi, and welcome to Exploring Hobbies. I'm Jamie Fouché, and today we are going to be talking with Eric Bauer about Legos. Welcome. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
So how did you get started with Legos?
As a kid, just remembered getting them for Christmas and birthdays and fell in love with them immediately. As I got older, drifted away from Lego in the junior high, high school, and even college years. And then I blame my wife for getting me back into them. When we started dating for Christmas, our first Christmas together, she gave me a little castle Lego set. She had a philosophy that she thought everybody should get a toy at Christmas. I got it, was blown away, like, wow, cool. Built it, and then slowly started looking at them in the stores a little bit more. And then I remember I was out on the road working for a job. I traveled a lot, and I was eating French toast for breakfast, and we were listening to NPR, and they made an announcement that Lego got a licensing agreement with Lucas to build Star Wars sets, and it was all over after that. Headed to the store immediately to start finding them and sneaking them into the house, and that's where it all started.
And did you find when you started working with them again that the sets had all completely changed from when you were a kid?
Completely and totally. When I was building as a child, it was all very square bricks, maybe some rectangles and plates, and it was very rudimentary. Now, any piece you can think of, they make. They're still mostly angular and 90-degree angles and things, and that's where the creativity comes in, and the way you build is trying to make round objects out of square pieces can be challenging, but they make it a lot easier for you.
Yeah. So once you got reintroduced to Legos and started doing that again, how did that transition into a real hobby as opposed to something you just kind of tinkered with?
I don't know about... My wife will tell you I liked to accumulate Lego more than anything. So that was where I started, really, was I'd just see things and I'd buy it up and I really liked it and never got around to building them. But then definitely when I had kids and they started getting into the age of buying them Lego and starting to play with them more, it kind of reawoken that desire to actually sit down and build and create things on my own with the parts that I had. And that finally led to looking for other people in the area. That I figured I couldn't be the only one that was into Lego, and I found the Michigan Lego user group and joined up with them and been going to meetings and doing shows with them ever since.
So what kind of things do you do at meetings? If someone wants to get involved with other people with Legos, what can they expect out of a user group and a meeting?
We have 6 meetings a year every other month. Usually the first thing we talk about is kind of upcoming shows that we're going to be doing, figuring out who's going to bring what kind of items to the display, what display we want to do, map out what the display is going to look like. Then obviously we all talk about the latest products that are coming out, what we've bought, and then kind of show off what we've made, bring models that are various points of completion and kind of get feedback from people and get ideas on how to make it better and just really enjoy the brick.
How do you get ideas for your shows? Are there themes? Is it all up to you? How does that work?
Most of the shows we do are train shows. So we run train track all around it. We've never done the same show twice. It's always, multiple people have certain buildings that they create and they keep those together for a while, so they'll make multiple appearances, but the layouts are always different mixtures of buildings, things like that. Mm-hmm. We also do some non-train shows where we might do an entire Hoth layout from Star Wars with AT-ATs and snow speeders and snow troopers and things like that. Kind of depends on the venue it's going to be displayed at, and sometimes they'll request certain things and try to oblige them.
What's the typical size of the display? Is it, you know, like we've got a few things here that you brought in that for us to take a look at? Is it just a few things? Is it, you know, a great big table, a whole floor? What's that look like?
Generally, they're pretty huge. The smallest one we've ever done was 5 by 10 foot square rectangle of things, roughly 100,000 bricks in that layout. The largest one we ever did was with the National Model Railroad Association. They had a big show down in Cobo Hall, and that was a 30 by 40 foot display, well over a million bricks in that, and that was in a 10,000 square foot facility with seven other clubs, so that was a huge one. Generally, it's about half that size, I'd say 12 by 20, a good dozen or so buildings, and then some little themed areas. Like one guy has a dinosaur park that makes an appearance from time to time. Sometimes it's a full farm with crops and a little plain crop dusting over the top. Whatever we're feeling like, whatever hasn't made an appearance in a while, try to bring those out.
Wherever creativity takes you.
Exactly.
Huh? And are the shows all year round? Is there kind of a busy season? How does that work if people are interested in coming to see the shows?
They are year round. Our busy season is definitely the holidays between Thanksgiving and New Year. We'll do five shows in that period. A lot of that time, there's three or four shows going on at a given time. Those upcoming shows at the holidays are at places like the Henry Ford, the DSO, the Detroit Zoo will be on there for the first time the holiday season. And the upcoming ones, we have one in September. Mm-hmm. It's at this is a new one, it's the Detroit Design Festival downtown. And then in October, it's the Detroit Fanfare Comic Con.
So
a lot of the same-minded people at comic conventions that we get to display our stuff with them too.
Yeah, that's great. You mentioned a big variety of different kinds of stuff that you put into your shows. What are some of the more creative things that you think you guys have put into your shows? What have you designed?
Some of the more creative things haven't really gone into our standard shows.
Okay.
One of the club members, Jim, he builds very large scale. He has an 11-foot replica of the Penobscot building that is absolutely perfect. Many years ago, we did a 6-foot Tony the Tiger sculpture and little 3-foot Snap, Crackle, and Pop character sculptures for the Kellogg Museum. Things like that. Those were sponsored events. At the shows, there are some very creative buildings out there. I know at the one show we did recently, there was I loved it because I loved the place. It was a Hunter House Burgers. Mm-hmm. It's the just a basic white building, but instantly recognizable to anybody in the area and that's ever had one of their delicious burgers. Things like that, little local icons that try to add in there that people can recognize. And then most of the displays you'll find, try to get creative with those. Sometimes the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles will make an appearance. They'll be fighting a battle off in one scene. And if you look closely enough, you'll see Spider-Man swinging between two towers, things like that.
Great.
Make it fun.
Yeah.
Things for the kids to pick out and grab their mom. Mom, look at that.
Things to spy if you're paying attention.
Exactly.
Little hidden Easter egg kind
exactly.
of thing. Exactly. Very good. So for the user groups or clubs, are those sponsored by Lego? Is there a partnership there?
They're not sponsored by Lego. We don't represent them officially, but they do support us. One time a year, we have an opportunity to buy a limited amount of parts at a discounted rate. And it's for some of the major shows where there's a lot of people and it's a bigger draw, sometimes they'll provide some product to help our display and make it as best as possible. Things like the base plates and the road plates so we can really flesh out a town. They'll help with that. They know about us and it's just not an official relationship.
Yeah. You talked about how the sets, even that you can buy at the stores, have really changed in terms of there's more shapes and unique types of parts that come with the kit. In addition to that, are there other places or sources that you guys have to get things? Like, I know you've got some lights and that sort of thing. I'm sure there's things with motion. Where do you find that stuff? If it doesn't come to a store, do you have secret sources for that where you can get things?
Absolutely. The Lego hobby as it is today would be nothing like it is without the internet. The internet made it possible for us all to find each other and share stories. Along with that, certain things have cropped up over the years. There's places, there's a website called bricklink.com where fans of Lego like myself will buy up sets, and I might only want a couple of pieces out of those sets or a couple of the minifigures and not really be interested in the set itself. I can go on bricklink.com, I can list those parts for sale, and then other Lego fans around the world who are looking for those will find it and then purchase it. It's beautiful. I get rid of the parts that I don't want.
Yeah.
I get money to buy more Lego. They get the pieces, the exact pieces they need and the quantities they need to build out their creations. Lego actually does the same thing with parts that are currently in production on a smaller scale. You can go to shop.lego.com and buy parts by the brick. And even at the Lego store at Somerset Mall, they have, if you haven't been there, they have a wall in the back that's filled with maybe 30 bins of different pieces that you get little plastic cups, you go in and you fish out the ones you want and you fill up the cup and take it home.
Yeah.
You mentioned the lights. There are little companies who have started up as well. Brickstuff.com, they design LED lighting kits to bring life to your creations. There's also companies called Brick Arms or Brick Mania. They provide military replicas. Lego will never make a modern day military set. They just don't want to get into that. Some of these companies will. They'll make the little machine guns and handguns for their minifigures, and they build some truly beautiful, like World War II displays. It's impressive to see. It's so that people find a niche and they grow the hobby in any way they can.
Yeah, so it sounds like there's been a real change and growth in the industry just as a result of people wanting to do more than just play with it as kids, and as it's developed into shows and user groups and that sort of thing, that little
a little
business has formed around that.
Absolutely.
And supporting those groups. Talk to me a little bit about, with the user groups, are there different user groups for different ages? Is there a difference between, if your child wants to get more involved with it versus you, an adult, want to get more involved with it? What can people expect from that?
I think it is true across all of the LEGO user groups. To be a full member, you have to be 18 or older. You can be a junior member between the ages of 14 and 17, but you need adult supervision with you at the events, and it really isn't for children younger than that. They're obviously welcome at the meetings and things. I've brought my kids to a meeting, and it's fun for them to see, but they cannot be full members. It's fun. I like
it. Okay. So it really is more, this is adults being creative and coming together around this, and not necessarily intended for kids after school activity kind of thing. It's really more for a more serious
hobbyist. Yes.
That it's the adults. Okay, that makes sense. And are there dues? Are there any certain requirements around being a member? Do people just kind of come and go? How does that work if someone's interested in joining the user group?
The Michigan group, we do not have any dues. Our only requirements are that you attend one meeting a year and help out at one show a year. That could be helping setting up or tearing down and being there watching the displays while they're in place. That's really it.
Probably it.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Good. Would you say that if it becomes more than just tinkering, does it become an expensive hobby?
It is very expensive. There is no doubt about that. But it can all, if you do it right, it can be self-funding, and that's the way it is for me. Lego is obviously a luxury good. It's a hobby. I'm not going to spend my family's money on it and things like that. I'll buy up sets and sell the pieces that I don't need on BrickLink to finance my next purchases. Lego sets are also retired periodically. They only stay on the shelves for a year or two. Especially some of the licensed sets. If people don't buy them at that time and they're no longer available, and they find them 2 years later and they find out about them, they always want to get their hands on them. And that's when I can sell my sets for a profit at that point and, again, pay for my future purchases.
Buy more.
It's everything I sell Lego wise, it goes right back into the Lego fund.
Back into the Lego fund. Buy more. Very good. Very good. You mentioned we know that the sets have changed in terms of the building blocks, but we were talking a little bit before we started, and you've brought some of these figures with me. Talk to me a little bit about those and how those might be different from the sets that some of us had when we were kids.
One of the big changes, the biggest change that came about with the minifigures is they started changing the color of the skin tone. In the past, all Lego minifigures had yellow heads, and with the introduction of the licensed sets like Star Wars and the Avengers, they started coming out with the flesh tone colors. With the licensed sets, I don't know if you can tell, back in the day, all Lego minifigure heads were just plain yellow. And now with some of the licensed sets, they have started adding in flesh tones to represent the specific characters, like Thor and Captain Jack Sparrow down there, and the Star Wars ones with Han Solo. That was one of the big changes, was changing the color of the figures. It just gives you so much more variety. Now we have the Avengers, we have Batman. I have my Captain Jack Sparrow, who's been a favorite character of mine for years. And Lego has also started recently these collectible minifigures. A couple times a year, they'll put out a series of 16 figures that come in. They call them blind bags. It's just one little bag that you don't know who you're buying, so you pick it up and you take it home, you open it up and you see who you get, and you try to collect all 16. And to date, I have just about every one of them, sadly.
That's fun. It sounds like the shows that you've been talking about have been local, which makes sense because you guys are a local user group. Are there also, like, national level, are there conventions or big shows, maybe like at Legoland or someplace like that, where, you know, there's a broader range to get together and meet with people who are maybe not from your own user group but from other clubs and groups around the country?
Yep, absolutely. Right now I think there's 93 Lego user groups in North America. I think in every state in the nation, as well as 24 up in Canada. There are national shows, the names are escaping me. The one I know is Brick World, that was in Fort Wayne, Indiana. There was just one recently in Chicago, and there's usually one out west, like in the Seattle area. Sadly, I have not been able to make it out to one of those yet. I can't get my wife to okay that just yet, but hopefully at some point I will. Even for us, we do shows outside of the Metro Detroit area. We have one going on right now in Midland and one up in a museum in Traverse City that's been there for most of the summer and will be there through the fall.
Very good, very good. If people want more information about how to get involved with a Lego user group or just Legos in general, you know, what are some of the resources out there available to them?
Our website is michlug.org, so it's michlug.org. The Lego website, lego.com, is a great resource. There's several forums where you can go and see beautiful models and talk about Lego. The biggest one that I go to all the time is eurobricks.com. Okay. Started out as a European website, but they've kind of taken over as the main Lego site out there right now. Oddly now, Flickr.com is taking over with just a flood of Lego photography, and that's kind of where I find myself going with the hobby more and more, is lighting sets and getting the nighttime street scenes with the little collectible minifigures. I like setting up scenes and then just getting realistic shots of them. And then doing goofy shots like Darth Vader riding on a bike through town. It's one of the things I enjoy.
So it sounds like kind of another side hobby that spun off of this, you're saying, is photography. So setting up, like you said, shots around Legos. Talk to me a little bit more about that. So where, and is there, where could people go to see those kind of shots if they want to see them?
Flickr is the best place for it. Yeah. There's a gentleman in the Netherlands that I just started talking to via Flickr, and he takes beautiful shots. He'll build his model, and he specializes in Star Wars scenes from Empire Strikes Back on the planet Hoth. He'll build like a snow speeder, put it in a fish tank, fill it with water, and then he sprinkles baking soda over the top, and it slowly drifts down. It's a very slow process.
Yeah.
But his effects of snow falling and snow covering things are beautiful. And it's very impressive to see. And along with the still photography, another thing that people are really getting into now is Lego stop motion animations. Like if you go to YouTube and you type in just Lego, the first five hits you get will be fan-made Lego animations that have gotten 5 or 6 million hits. And that's one of the things my son will do. He'll just jump on the iPad and go on YouTube and just watch Lego videos for hours.
That's neat, that's neat. Have any of your ideas turned into new sets from Lego?
Not personally. That would be a dream, but Lego does have a website. It's Kusu. And it's a place where builders can create things. They submit them. They kind of do their own PR and get people to go look at them and take a look at their sets and comment on them. And then people can support them. If those sets gain enough support, they do become Lego sets that you can buy. The newest one out right now, which I'm very excited to get, it's going to go on sale, I think, August 1st, is the Back to the Future DeLorean with a little Marty McFly and a little, I can't think of his name, the Doc. The last set that came out from Kusu was something that I couldn't really get into, but again, it's something my son and all his friends are into, is Minecraft. It was a little Lego Minecraft set, and that did so well for him. It sold out multiple times, and they had to keep adding new production runs. And they just announced at San Diego Comic Con that they're going to create two more Minecraft sets to go along with the first one. So it can happen.
Yeah, it's interesting how much popular culture influences the Lego sets. You know, Minecraft is a hugely popular video game, you know, so that doesn't surprise me at all that, you know, that computer game has influenced Legos too. I think that's great.
I think it was a perfect mix for video games because it's just little blocks.
And yeah, I mean, the feel of the game is very much building like you would, only you're doing it in an online virtual world instead of live.
I think the pop culture has a lot to do with it. You see it more and more in TV, at least with the shows I watch. Lego will be on The Big Bang Theory from time to time. And I remember he was building his Death Star on there, and I was very jealous. And I finally got my Death Star of my own shortly after I saw it on the show.
Do you have ideas of sets that you would like to see them come out with that don't exist?
Oh, boy.
If you had your wish list of the new sets that they do, what would be on it?
They've done most of them. The one that I wish they would and pray that they redo is a Millennium Falcon. I love the one that I have, but several years ago, Lego had created a huge Millennium Falcon. It would have barely fit on the table. And at the time, it was $500 when it came out.
Yeah.
And I just could not justify paying $500 for a Lego set. And it even got discounted after a while because it wasn't selling well, or it was towards the end of its life cycle. And the lowest I saw it was for $350. I still couldn't do it. And now if you go on eBay, it'll be $2,000, brand new in the box. And definitely can't justify that. So I want it badly. And that's the one I would pray for them to come back out with.
Okay, so refreshed Millennium Falcon at a different price point.
I'd even pay the $500
at this point.
And
what else did you bring with you? You've got a couple things here.
These ones are from their modular buildings. Right. They're different in the fact that they're a lot larger scale than the typical Lego building that you would find. And they're also four-sided. And then they come apart so you can get at the interiors and see what's going on. This one is an attic, and you could see that there was some
pieces
crates.
Inside. Yeah,
I stored some pieces in there, but there was some crates that somebody had stored in the attic of their building, and even on the back side of it, the little door, this person had created a little
garden. Porch there with a garden.
So this is probably my favorite series right now, and the one that, if I had my way, they would go further out with this. They've had a little corner hotel. There's been a downtown grocery store, a town hall. This one is a part a pet shop and just like a brownstone building. And there was a fire department. I'd very much like to see like a police department, a post office, and a bank, and like a restaurant, like a pizza parlor or something. Mm-hmm. That's I'm glad they keep it to one a year, just because they're on the more expensive end for the Lego sets. But these are the ones I like the detail. They're just different than Lego was when I was a child, and they tell a better story. At our shows, these would be on the small side.
Okay.
Our buildings are...
The scale of the buildings
are much
bigger.
But they're the same style, same level of detail. They're very impressive to see.
Yeah. Well, I'm impressed with what I see, and it has been really interesting hearing about, you know, I had no idea that all this is out there, and I'm sure there are a lot of other people who loved it as kids and are probably excited to hear that they can follow that passion as adults too and
absolutely
get even more creative and have that there's so much more out there to do with it. Share with us again how we can get in touch with your user group if someone would like to join you.
They can contact us at michlug.org. It's michlug.org. We're also on Facebook and Twitter as well.
Okay, great. Eric, thanks so much for coming and talking with
Absolutely.
Us today. It's been really great.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you all for joining us on Exploring Hobbies.